Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to Grace Food Church. Glad to have you all here this day as we come for a very special service together. My name is Pastor Josh Molnauer. I'm the pastor here, and of course, I'd like to welcome you all to our congregation. I think I can safely say this is the most flowers I've seen, and you know, just about ever. It's also just about the most people we've had here in a very long time. And as I told Myron beforehand, this was kind of a wonderful thing. I mean, the Brempies have a big family, but there's a whole lot of family and friends here. A chance for community and fellowship, a chance to remember that you were loved and cared for, and so very much so we should. A couple announcements before we begin, though. First is you're going to want to make sure you have a bulletin for the service. So if you don't have one, you want to sneak into the narthex and grab one, or put your hand up the usher and get you one. And then make sure you bring the service bulletin along to the cemetery. They're going to have a committal service, which is actually in there, and we'll be singing. So make sure you bring the service along. After the committal service in the cemetery, we have a big, huge luncheon planned in the fellowship hall. You're all very much encouraged and welcome to come to that. We'd love to have you in time for fellowship and enjoy together. So everyone's encouraged to stick around for that. For those who might not want to go to the cemetery, maybe because of the weather or health reasons, you're also welcome to stay here at the church in the meantime while the rest of us go there and come back. So those are some announcements, but we're here in our great God's presence, and we're here to praise Him. So we start off our service by singing an opening hymn. You see there in your bulletins, and we are standing, so we sing that hymn of praise together.
Thank you.
called a pall cloth, which, as we're going to talk about in a second, is a reminder of the white that's hers, cleanliness that is hers through baptism. And ours has a "He is risen" on it, which reminds us of the whiteness we have, the cleansing we have, is ours through Christ and His resurrection. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In holy baptism, Verna was clothed with the robe of Christ's righteousness that covered all of her sins. St. Paul says, "Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into His death?"
We are buried, therefore, with Him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life.
For if we have been united with Him in a death like His,
we shall certainly be united with Him in a resurrection like His.
I lift up my eyes to the hills.
Where does my help come from?
My help comes from the Lord,
the Maker of heaven and earth.
The Lord watches over you.
The Lord is the shade at your right hand.
The sun will not harm you by day,
nor will it by night.
The Lord will keep you from all harm.
He will watch over your life.
The Lord will watch over your coming and going,
both now and forevermore. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of grace and mercy, we give thanks for your loving kindness shown to Verna and to all your servants, who, having finished their course in faith, now rest from their labors. Grant that we also may be faithful unto death and receive the crown of eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Parents may be seated for an Old Testament reading.
Greetings for this day. Ecclesiastes 3, 1 to 11. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant. A time to pluck up what is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down, a time to build up, a time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to cast away stones, and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek, and a time to lose. A time to keep and time to cast away. A time to tear and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading, St. Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 1, verses 16 through 17. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and then to the Greek. For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith. As it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. This is the word of Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me, and yet you do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated.
Grace, mercy, and peace be unto God, our Father, from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, friends, grandkids, great-grandkids, sons and daughters, and a husband. Let me start off with a little story. When I first started here as a pastor some years ago, it was made clear to me that that room over there is a sacristy. That's where the altar guild ladies do all their things. They have the wine and the banners and all the stuff they do over there. That's what they take care of. This room over here is the vestry. This is where we have all the pastor robes, the pastor stoles, the pastor crosses things, the acolyte robes, all that stuff's over there. So pastor kind of has that room that he takes care of. Okay, fine. So you guys sort of know how it is, right? At the end of the service, the acolytes are not in a hurry to stick around. So the acolyte quit, and then he takes a robe and kind of like throw it over there on a hanger, sort of. And sometimes after a long service, I'm kind of ready to get back there and have some cookies in the fellowship hall. So I walk in there and just kind of, you know, throw my robe somewhere close to a hanger and then walk back there. This went on for a couple of years until one day I walk into the vestry room here and it is pristine. Someone has cleaned the whole thing. They've organized it all. They've labeled things, including my robe, so that no one else will use my robes. It's labeled Pastor Josh. And they put all the sacrament robes on one side and all the other robes on the other side, and all the nice stoles are all lined up just perfectly. It's been swept. It's been cleaned. It looks immaculate. And I'm scratching my head thinking, who in the world did that? And then, of course, you know what happens. After the service, I get one of those little things in burner where she goes like this. And I go over there, and she says, Pastor, I'm sorry, but I just cleaned your room. I went in there the other day, and it was just so messy that I just kind of cleaned it up over there. I hope you're not mad. And how can I be mad? I mean, she cleaned the place up. It was beautiful. She just took it upon herself to do it. I mean, I couldn't think of any other person in our church who would just, of their own free volition, just go in there and move everything around and rearrange how she thought it should look. Which, if you stop to think about it a little bit, is sort of, how the gospel works. Christ goes on a cross and dies. He doesn't ask us, well, do you think I should clean up the mess of the civilization that you guys are? Do you think you need some help with that? I mean, it looks like it's kind of messing and not doing a good enough job. Do you mind if I step in and help? Well, he doesn't ask us. He doesn't take a poll. He doesn't ask for permission. He just does it. He just goes up on a cross out of love and kindness and compassion. He dies for everything. And then he rises again with victorious resurrection power for everyone. It's not something that we have to earn or ask for. We just get it like a free gift, like someone who comes over and cleans your house for you, immaculate, unexpectedly, wonderful. Done. That's the gospel. That's what the gospel is like. But of course, the gospel is bigger. It's more than that. The gospel is just what happened 2,000 years ago on a wonderful cross, on a really good Friday, and a really even better Easter. The gospel is what happens also in people's lives. When they live and die and live again. The gospel is what happens in someone's life like Bernice. When she dies, goes to heaven, and God doesn't ask her, okay, here's the list of stuff you've done in your life. I don't think it's quite long enough. She doesn't have to ask her a bunch of confirmation questions. She doesn't have to prove she's good enough. She doesn't have to do something, make some perfect pie or something. No, no, no. Heaven comes to her as a free and wonderful gift, really done by Christ, really given for her. It's actually a beautiful example of the gospel. It's actually sort of like a crowded room. Like, well, maybe this one. Except there would be a dance hall room. And there would be people dancing all around. There would be one young gal sitting up on a side by herself. And Christ would come over to her, this young man, and reach out his hand and say, I want to dance with you. I want you to be mine always. And he'd sweep her off her feet, and they would dance. Square dance, of course, for eternity. That's sort of what heaven is like. That's sort of what the gospel is. God coming over and saying, hey, I have this wonderful thing for you, a whole new life for you. Come follow me and we'll do this together. But But of course, the gospel is more than that. It's even bigger than that, because the gospel is not just something that happens when we die up in heaven. It's something that impacts everyday lives. It's something that impacts people in here. It's something that could, for instance, impact a woman and give her amazing amounts of patience, especially with raising four little boys. And I'm sure these four little boys, when I said they were always angels when they were young, and they never jumped on the furniture, and they never made messes, and they never made her pull her hair out, but we probably know all this. Not quite sure. And yet, God's grace, God's gospel would come through into someone's life like hers and fill her with the kindness and the patience to love those boys and to raise those little whippersnappers into men who would be faithful and good. It would fill her with the kind of kindness towards others, which would help her to look after a grandfather who needed help when he was injured, and would look after a grandson when he needed a place to live. It's the kind of love that would move her to do things, like move her arms to do things and show that love, show that kind of care, show that kind of compassion to others. The gospel is sometimes just like a freshly made loaf of banana bread, all sliced up just perfectly by her just perfect recipe and handed. It's nice, but it's even more than what it tastes like. It's an expression of love, expression of what's in here. She loves you, so she's giving it to you to eat and enjoy. That's kind of what the gospel is like. It works inside someone's heart to transform them, to make them better, to make them love. But the gospel is even bigger than that, even better and more powerful than that. Not just something that happens in someone's life, it's something that happens in all of our lives. Because God's power is at work in each and every one of you. The kind of power that can transform a day like today, which could be a day of just sadness and tears, but into a day filled with hope and even maybe some laughter. Because we know today is not the end, death is not the end of the story, it's just sort of like the new beginning. Hope we have in heaven of a Christ that lives forever, and we live forever with him. It transforms day into all sorts of kind of excitement and hope and joy and even peace. God's gospel comes into our lives and we feel ourselves transformed, and we think about that one family member who may be kind of odd, maybe kind of annoying, but we take time to be a little more kind with them. A little more patient with that, a little more loving. It's for those times when we feel maybe kind of all alone and sad, like no one else is there, and we know that's not true. But the gospel fills us with the truth that God is always with us, that Christ is right there sitting next to us always. Even when we're alone in some rocking chair, God is there, and he cares deeply. It's the kind of love we have, the kind of gospel we have that transforms our everyday lives. We don't just do the things we want to do because it sounds good. We find ourselves actually living for God because he is good. He has good things in store for us. Yeah, that's kind of what the gospel is like. This big, huge, powerful thing at work in the lives of God's people throughout the centuries and lives of God's beloved people here today in the lives of you. So are we ashamed of the gospel? Oh no. This is the power of God, the salvation of all who believe. You, me, her. And now may the peace of our God, which transcends all our human understanding, and guard your hearts, your minds, in Christ Jesus today and always. And then now we have a special piano piece from a special grandchild who's going to. Thank you. as we confess our faith and thank you. God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ. Together in trust and hope, we confess our faith.
I believe in your God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We just said that we believe in the communion of saints, the fact that your faith in Christ unites you to everyone else who has faith in Christ also. That brings us into a wonderful and shared communion of fellowship of believers. So in light of that, Myron and I would actually encourage all of you to hold hands during the prayer. It's kind of a sign of that internal spiritual unity we have as members connected to Christ. So let us pray. Let us pray to the Lord our God and Father, who raised Jesus Christ from the dead. Almighty God, we thank you for having created Verna, for making her in your image. We thank you for all the talents and abilities you granted to her and all she was able to pass on to her family and friends. For all this, we praise you, Lord, in your mercy, for sending your only begotten Son, Jesus, into this world to die and rise again for Verna's sins. Bring her to faith in Christ Jesus and nurture a faith in her that would sustain her throughout all her years. For opening to Verna the way of everlasting life, which she now enjoys the start of. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. For this we praise you, gracious Lord, Lord in your mercy. For all those who mourn this day, that you would comfort them with the sure and certain hope of the resurrection through Jesus Christ, for all those who believe in you. Point them ahead to the heavenly reunion that awaits all the saints who hold fast to the faith and finish the race. Lord, in your mercy, for all of us to say that the power of your gospel would be at work in our lives, help us to follow you ever more faithfully, trusting in your power and goodness all of our days. Shepherd us throughout our earthly lives and into the life that is to come. Lord, in your mercy, and taught by our Lord and trusting his promises, we are bold to pray together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
I am the resurrection and life, says the Lord. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. Whoever lives and believes in me will never die.
Lord, I now let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of every people. A light is revealed to the nations, and the glory of your people Israel.
Blessed are those who mourn,
for they shall be comforted.
Blessed are the pure in heart,
for they shall see God.
Blessed be the name of the Lord,
both now and forevermore.
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and grant to you his peace.
Amen.
Amen. We stand closing in together.